Good morning, all. Thank you, Pedro. It's my pleasure to present this second session and inviting Jean-Claude Brueggemann, that is the head of unit of data, open access, and foresight at the Directorate General of RTD and chair of the Open Science Task Force. Jean-Claude Brueggemann is very well known, and we've been working on framing European policies for several years. He was, among other things, he was very instrumental on the consultation on Science 2.0, as it was the name at that time, Open Science in 2014 too. Jean-Claude, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Okay. So I'll do that like the pop stars. I take the microphone. So it's a pleasure. Ah, voilà.
Sorry. Thank you.
So now, does this work? Okay. So it's a pleasure to be here. I think it's the first presentation I did at a scientific conference outside my own country, which is Belgium, was in Barcelona. But that was in the Stone Age, so a long time ago. So it's really nice to be. And it was at this university, but I can't remember in which room it was. But anyway, it's a pleasure to be here. So I should have been to give you a little bit of a hint. So I should have been at the RDA Funders Forum meeting, but I thought this to be more interesting. So I'm sorry for the RDA people to be here, because I think this is very important, what the topic you are addressing and the deliberations that follow. And it has already been hinted several times by the previous speakers are crucial for the future of open data in particular, and the open science cloud in general. It is my personal conviction as a policymaker, which I am now, and I'm not a lawyer, that if we cannot sort out two non-technical issues, one is, well, they have always technical ramifications, but in essence they are not technical. One is the legal and the other is the economic, the business case of repositories and open science clouds. If we cannot sort it out in Europe relatively quickly, I'm not talking about 5 or 10 years, but even sooner, we will probably lose it. We will lose the opportunity to create a commons for open research data in Europe. It's my personal view, but I think there are a lot of indicators, and we can come back to that in the discussion if you want. There are a lot of indicators pointing in that direction. So I was asked to give you a bit of an overview of what we are doing and what we are planning. And I think that in a nutshell, The issues that were presented by the excellent previous speakers and which are on the table now will only become more complex the more we push forward the policies on open access and on open data. So it is really only the beginning of where we stand rather than the end. So just to give you a little bit of history, and I think It's quite nice to hear that in this area the Commission is not always criticized, but always sometimes even thanked for what we did. And I think together with the community, we have walked a long way to promoting open access, and you see the evolution there. And from the next framework program onwards, meaning 2020 and onwards, from then on it will be simply default across the board, publications, data, and so on. So it is actually remarkable that we were able, not we Commission, but we as community, to go so fast ahead if you look at it in retrospect. So that is an important perspective to be taken, and I think we should congratulate ourselves as European research community on that. So where we are now, the issues for open data are very well embedded in the regulatory provisions for the framework programs. You see them listed there. It is a legal issue, so there is a framework for that exists, and the previous speakers have already alluded to that as well, so that's not so important. What is important to remember and what is important to look at is the experiences we had with the Open Research Data Pilot. So I'm not talking here about publications and the open access obligations, which is a different discussion. We are now focusing on the open research data, part of our policies on open access, and in particular the pilot. So as you know, the pilot was introduced for a limited amount of areas, research areas in the framework program. from the start, it had the robust and opt-outs, so provisions for robust opt-out, depending on IPR, confidentiality, privacy, the points that were raised by the previous speakers, but also security issues. So that is an important position that has been taken, and where we learned a lot, and it also explains why, even though open data becomes default, the opt-outs will remain there, because they learned some significant lessons for the future, and they came much into the concerns of businesses and legal advocates not going for a mandatory open access policy across the board without having exceptions. So that is important. We mainly look at, and I think it is really important in our discussions on open data, that we say what are the data we are talking about, the pilot and also the future, so the follow-up, so the default version of the pilot, so if you want, is mainly looking at the data underlying publications. And so we are not talking about data in abstractum, because in a certain sense, yes, all data in a certain sense are personal, in a certain sense all data can be used for research. Whatever you produce can be research. You can correlate today anything to anything else. So in a certain sense, everything that is digital and everything becomes digital is a data source. So if we start solving ex ante, what is the status of all this potential new data to be developed for the use of research, I personally think we will never get there. So we try to focus rather limited on the data underlying, so open access, the data underlying the publications that were made into open access. And that makes it a little bit more manageable to come up with solutions, because you're talking about a much more restricted corpus of data there. This being said, in FP7, so the previous program before Horizon 2020, there were close to 200,000 publications, so it is not neglectable. And it is not only the data leading to the publication, but also everything that you need to make those data, to make sense out of those data. So it is quite significant in a certain sense. But anyway, so we are focusing on data underlying the publications. And a DMP in the pilot and also in the future, so data management plan, is therefore obligatory for the projects that do not opt out of the obligation. So that will also remain in the future. Costs are fully eligible. It's an important issue to make the DMPs. And whether projects opt out or not does not affect the evaluation. That was a very important lesson to be learned, because you could also say as a policymaker, well, if you don't want to opt in, we or if you opt out, we consider this as a negative trademark, as a negative evaluation for your project. So that hasn't been done, and that came. That was very much appreciated, because the point was mentioned in particularly by industry. So the industrial consortia, or the consortia involving industry, very much appreciated this possibility. So the mantra, as said by the first speaker, is indeed as open as possible, as closed as needed. Now here are a bit of the reasons why, from the projects deciding to opt to take part into the pilot, so the more or less the rate of opting out was 30-35%, and from those areas not taking part in the pilot on a voluntary basis, 14% opted in. So you can say that on average the take up of the pilot was quite positive. Even more closer. So you can say that the take-up of the pilot was quite positive, all in all. So a significant amount staying there, 65%, depending on the areas. But anyway, that's the average, and a relatively interesting amount opting in. Now, if you imagine this on a larger scale and you go for the default version from September onwards, we have 30 billion of research money remaining in the framework program. And if we have the same amount in the next framework program, which will be 80 billion, it means that we are producing for around 70 billion worth of open data in a certain sense, because that will be the totality or the percentage of the framework program that is taking part in the open data, so not opting out. So that's a significant volume data, and I would say it's a quite positive effect. It's not 100%, but nothing is perfect, certainly not the world. So I think it is very encouraging. What you can see there is also what are the main reasons for opting out. So the colored bars give you the main reasons why, from the 35% that did not want to stay into the pilot, why they opted out. And then you see that in the main reason for opting out is IPR. So this is of course concerns in particular from the industry. To a lesser extent, again, 20% of the 35% opting out is related to privacy and is related to all the issues that were so eloquently discussed before that. An almost equal percentage is there as a category saying that, well, our project does not generate data, so we don't have to take part in the data pilot, which, by the way, my personal view is a very strange way of thinking. Science without data is a little bit, even if the data is text is also data. So, but anyway, the category is foreseen and so on. So it was listed. So you go there to have an overview of all the different reasons. So in a certain sense, the issue of what has been discussed this morning and what you will discuss the rest of the day, it is a relatively limited amount of projects on the total volume of so many billions of research money that decide to opt out for reasons related to personal data. That's what you see there. So you have to put the things into proportion. An overwhelming part of research projects do see the benefit of open data. And as we said, as open as possible, as closed as needed. If you give the provisions to opting out, it seems to me that the industry and the privacy advocates and the health people and so on are very relaxed about the way we do the policy. So I think this is a quite important lesson that we learned from our pilot. Now, as I said, I mean, our view is so we are no longer only talking about openness, so about access to data, but also about how make these data reusable, findable, accessible, and interoperable, the famous FAIR acronym. So the next step in the policy is not only open, but also make it fair. And that is, of course, a very important part of what we want to do in the future, DMPs, and in the policies that we will start to implement after the summer when the pilot becomes default and where we will go into the full default in the framework program, in the next framework program. So FAIR, as you know, is much more than openness. FAIR is really, openness is only, let's say, addressing the A of FAIR, the accessibility. FAIR is about findability, interoperability, reusability, because that is what you need, all those four together, and that made operational is what you need to have reproducible science. And that's actually what open science is all about. Openness as such is quite meaningful if you can't reuse it. So that is where we are now working on how to translate FAIR principles into the DMPs, into the templates that we will provide for the data management plans in the future. And that will, as for those who have been working on it or with it with us, that will create some significant change in what is required, not in terms of, I would say, bureaucracy, but in terms of granularity of what you will provide in your DMPs. And it will also require, by the way, that we train our project officers to make them able to judge what will be provided there. So the FAIR data management plans that will become standard in the next framework, in the last part of the framework program and in the next framework program. So the things that you will get there, well, you see them, so that you will provide a template, which is a service, not an obligation, but that can always change, of course, but for the moment, that's the policy. We try to make the standard DMP as light and flexible as possible by guiding the submitter via a set of questions to the kind of answers that he has to give. it should be a DMP per project and not per data set, because that is all the that is really I think the most simplified solution possible, and I think much more than enough in terms of fair principles. And it should be, of course, a living document. It is something that can change over time. You can opt in and you can opt out across the ball of a project. So there are examples of projects that opted out and during the course of the project, after 2 years, decided to opt in into the data pilot because they thought, well, what we produce is not sensitive or not IPR related, so let's do it. The other way around happened as well. So that is also something we have to make sure that we can foresee in the future. Well, you get the guidelines there, so that's the portal. Let's not go into these details. Now, we also collected some experiences of the DMPs that were provided in of the project's part of the pilot, and the key lessons learned. You see them there. And there are a few good papers on that consultable on our website. So overall, we realized that additional guidance on data management is needed for all groups of actors in the research projects. That is something to take very serious. To be honest, I thought the level of awareness of data management to be a bit higher 3-4 years ago when we started working on this. And I think we have realized that outside the community of data people, and there are 1.7 million researchers in Europe, of which a few thousand of data people, so there are much more people not working on what we work. So there is really a little bit of agnosticism, to put it elegantly, on DMPs and data management and what it should be. So there is a lot of work to be done there in terms of raising awareness, guidance, training, follow-up, and so on. The second big lesson is that aspects such as data preservation, RPR standards, and so on, are all too often not very well documented in the answers of the DMPs that we have received so far. So it is a little bit a superficial way of arguing why for reason X, Y, Z a certain project cannot comply with the default of with the pilot, and we would like to go a little bit more into details to understand first of all better why, but secondly also to make at least the standard answer, well, it is not manageable from an IPR point of view, so we don't take part in the pilot, to avoid a little bit that kind of gratuit answers. Nevertheless, there was also a significant proportion of the DMPs that we could look at that were quite excellent, if not to say more than excellent, and for which we really can take a lot of best cases as examples for future projects to be submitted. So overall, the experience with the DMPs is let's say relatively positive, but it could be better. Like the weather, it's always good, but could be better. But in this case, I think we have to do much more effort there, and we are working really with a lot with our colleagues to try to remedy the lessons that we learned there. So fair data, if we now look to the future, and the fair data issue, it will not stop with the provisions of open access and open data in the framework program. If you look at it on the long term, but it starts today, it is the DNA of the European Open Science Cloud. That's the acronym. And the European Open Science Cloud, which is an idea and a project launched by our commissioner 18 months ago, which wants to offer a seamless European trusted third party for doing data research across boundaries, physical, and across disciplines. And that's what the pilot, that's what the Science Cloud wants to offer. If you picture it, it wants to offer, let's say, a commons as an environment for research and for data-driven research in Europe. That means That means that all the discussions and all the issues that were listed before will become articulated to the level X if you try to realize this trusted third party across boundaries and across nations in Europe. And that's why we say it is the DNA that if those data in the science cloud are not findable, accessible, interoperable, and reproducible, well, then you don't have a European science cloud. You might have many different clouds, and many of them probably private, but you will not have a European space for it. So that's why it is so important for future discussions. So that's our commissioner, where he have his view, so which he made public in the presidency event of in Amsterdam last year. That's the famous white paper where where the cloud initiative and our part, the science cloud, was announced. But I think maybe most of you are familiar with this document. But that, politically speaking, April 2016 was the official launch of the idea. So we are almost 1 year later and very close to making the cloud a reality by developing several policies, which I will not in detail tell you now, but if need be in the discussion. So the science cloud as such, the European Open Science Cloud, has four levels of policies to be addressed at. One is the easiest one, so to speak, is the technical one, the bottom one. Then the more you go up, the more it becomes, well, the more you go into the upper layers, the more you have a mix of technical and non-technical issues to be addressed. They are listed there. But if you translate that to FAIR, you can very easily see that in the block of open data content, the FAIR policies are extremely important. So that how to translate that in a European Open Science Cloud environment is what is on the agenda this year and next year. And idem dito, of course, for the infrastructures. To wind up, so what is next? So, on open access and open data, the decisions have been taken. It is mandatory from September onwards. So what is next is to translate these issues, and first of all to fine-tune them, the policies and the lessons learned, but then translate them into the environment of the Open Science Cloud. And that is where you see a few of the initiatives listed there. And if you want, I can come back to that in details later on. But you can see from that it is very high on our political agenda, our policy agenda, sorry. So what is our to wind up? Now I'm really winding up, so a few slides to conclude. So what is our common challenge as research community, policymakers, scientists, database builders, infrastructure people? I really think that we must make sure that not only we go for better science, but also for more productive, more reproducible science, that we can, in 10 years' time, come up with slides that you can no longer see the difference anymore, how many of these kind of initiatives are there. It has been proven that open data has an enormous value, not only for the quality of science and the speed of science, and as a consequence also the speed of innovation, but it is also a very economical, sensible thing to do. So we must really keep that in our mind and try to multiply these arguments. I also think that we have, and that's where I'm so interested to listen to your discussions, I think we have to try to come up with definitions of data which are dynamic and which fit open science. A static definition of what are data and who owns them is probably, but I'm not a lawyer, is probably something you can never achieve because the reality is continuously changing. What was open science 10 years ago is not open science 15 years ago, and we are increasingly realizing that if you want to reproduce science, you don't only need open data, you need open methods, you need open algorithms, you need actually open software. How that will fit into a data approach which is FAIR, quite frankly, I don't think that's such an easy thing to answer, and I'm really looking forward to the kind of answers that you can help us giving there, because OpenAIR is a community of people that works on this day in, day night, so to speak, at least day in. So that is a very important challenge, I would say, to make this dynamic data approach possible. This is a joke. We should not give in on quality. So that's for the good understander. I'll let you read this. And then, so finally, let's move fair from a concept to an operational reality for doing data-driven science at the European level to make open science a reality. And as I said in the beginning, let's do that as soon as possible, because I don't have to convince this kind of audience that there are a lot of private players on the market. So if you are really concerned about the European Commons, then we must make sure that the rules of the European Commons for research data are determined by the community and not by the providers from what kind they are. So working on these rules, which is the legal work is something that is very important, and something we are, as Commission, very much looking into your direction to come up with brilliant ideas. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Jean-Claude. Very interesting presentation. I think we have time for one question before going to the panel discussion.
Thanks a lot, Jean-Claude. I just can't resist ask you a question. So if you would have been at the Funders Forum, you would have been discussing this on a global level, and you decided to come to the European level. And my question to you is that, do you see Europe such a strong position, really, that we in Europe only can push the FAIR principles on a global scale, or do they come in? You had the links to some global efforts or some things, but you were mostly speaking about the European case. So how do you see the global view in the FAIR field landscape?
I do like Mick Jagger again. So now it's I think for the moment we have a strong position, and I also think for the moment that Europe is being followed by, in terms of what we are doing, is on the attention span of the policymakers globally. As some of you know, there is also a G7 initiative at the group of seven countries. They're not always the same. So they're working on this. There will be a ministerial conference in October, no, end of September, in Rome, and it deals with a global culture. There are two topics on the agenda on the ministers for science and technology. One is a global culture for research data, where a lot of the FAIR things are being proposed by us, and where most of our counterparts in the States and so on, Japan, think exactly the same. And the second issue is actually the incentives, but that's another issue. So I think for the moment we do have a strong position there, and we are still 31-32% of the scientific production in the world. So if you move as a block on that position, there is a highly likelihood that others will follow. How it is called is it varies across the globe, but I think in the science world, at least, I think that most of what we are defending in Europe is shared policy-wise, and if you then translate it to the political discussions, that's of course another discussion. This being said, I think we have to realize that other continents are moving fast also. So this is a little bit, it always reminds me to the situation in mobile telecommunications, or before that, but the beginning of the internet. You suddenly have several blocks, and at a certain moment one standard becomes operational. So we have to watch that moment and make sure it is our moment.